Welcome, everyone. We'll call the meeting to order. This is a special council meeting, a work session with the folks from SpringsNet to talk about the opportunities for municipal fiber network in Yellow Springs. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes, Wintrow.
Here.
Oh.
Here.
Sims.
Here.
Queen.
Yes.
Hemphley.
Yes.
Also present are village manager Patty Bates and assistant village manager Melissa Danzig.
Okay, so, I mean, do we have any announcements?
Well, I just wanted to mention for folks in the room that it's not being broadcast live, but it will be broadcast this Friday and Saturday, the 10th and 11th, at 6 a.m. noon and 6 p.m., and then it will be online on our YouTube station.
And we have I don't know that I'd even consider it to be an agenda. I mean, what we have here is what we presented to SpringsNet that we wanted to hear. I mean, my feeling is that we just turn the meeting over to them to do their presentation and expect that all of these areas will be answered. If they aren't, we'll ask questions. So I know that there are a lot of folks here. Can we start out by having you introduce the team that's been working on this and who's going to do the presentation?
Yes.
I'm looking at you, Thor, sorry.
Yeah, it's okay. So I'm Thor Sage. I'm the director at the Miami Valley Educational Computer Association. We're located right here in Yellow Springs, Ohio, in the building where the Greene County ESC is located on East Enon Road. As members of our team, if you don't mind, I'm just gonna kind of go around and let you introduce yourself. Tim?
Yeah, I'm Tim Barhorst. I'm a network engineer. I've lived in the village now for about 3.5 years, and I've got about 30 years of experience with computer networking, and that's all right now.
I'm Matt Cole. I'm an accountant in town.
I'm Ellis Jacobs. For my day job, I'm a lawyer, and I actually do some telecommunications law.
Doug McKinley. I'm an 18-year resident, and I recently retired from a manufacturing company where I oversaw the information technology.
I'm Scott Fife. I'm a 3.5-year village resident and neighbor of the village manager. In my previous life, I was the Director of Information Technology for the Centerville City School District in Montgomery County.
Jordan Gray. I was going to do part of the presentation, but my voice. New in the village in the last 2 years, and I'm a CTO, CIO of Honeycomb Digital. We manage digital files, large file transfer globally for corporate companies nationwide, multinational.
And Dan Kerrigan, I'm a librarian, science and technology librarian, and lived here almost 40 years.
So that's the whole team?
That's the team, the core
Great.
Team.
So we will just turn it over to whoever is doing the presentation. It looks like the man standing is ready.
Yep, I'm pretty much it, for starters anyway. So I'd like everybody to decompress. These are complex concepts, and we need to just take a deep breath and be patient and work through all the various elements of the opportunities that the village council and the village at large is willing to grapple with respect to fiber optic infrastructure implementation. We want you to deliberate. We don't expect anything to happen in one meeting. We don't expect every single question to be answered. We want you to do your independent analysis, and we want you to pepper us with questions. We want the dialogue. We do commend you for taking up these ideas, and I will just say that we really want to get out of lecture mode, and we want to talk with you rather than at you. So I'm not going to do a long, protracted presentation. We will answer all the items on the agenda, and if we don't, we trust that you'll let us know. But we have looked carefully at the agenda, and hopefully you did receive our FAQ as well. That was put together with the idea that it could be used anywhere, at any time, in any community, not, you know, specifically in Yellow Springs. So, please go ahead. So this is a graphic that is what we're calling our timeline. And it, now there's another copy of it back on the back wall. And we also have this in digital format so that we can send it to you at any time. But we want to just kind of recap where we've been and how we got here. The village council created a goal that said, develop and implement a plan to build a municipally owned fiber optic network that will support all Yellow Springs residents and encourage economic development. So that is exciting stuff to the techie folks. I can assure you of that. Go ahead and go back to the timeline. Okay, so right here in this first column is where we are today, and this is where we've been. We've actually been at this about 18 months now. It's been a pretty long haul. We created a SpringsNet initiative. We held a fiber forum. We noted happily the adoption of the Next Century Cities principles by the village council. We noted the creation of the village goal that I just read. We've done incredible amounts of research. We did issue a community survey and presented to council. And we invited Jeff Thumma from OFS to come and do a presentation about best practices with respect to municipal infrastructure. Here's where we are today. We're in this work session. We've got the date there, 6/8/16. And this is it. This is as far as we've come. And I think it's important to note that SpringsNet is not empowered to go any further. We put together a scenario where we believe we can demonstrate that fiber optic, the fiber to the home initiatives, fiber to the premise initiatives can be successful. They have been successful in other communities. And we, at this time, we need to hand this monster, I shouldn't call it a monster, but this body of work over to you and then help you sift through it so that you can make an informed decision about whether or not a fiber optic implementation is the right thing to do for Yellow Springs. We want you to analyze the risks and we want you to fully grasp the concepts. So as we move ahead, note that it says council resolves to move forward. We really do need the council to let us know whether or not we should continue, whether or not there are other things that you would like us to do, other information that we should bring to the table. We would recommend at the creation of an advisory board, the development of customer fact sheets, additional public discussion, and the definition of a project manager, or the creation of a project manager position, or the assignment of a project manager duty to really drive this thing home. Somebody who can make decisions, because we're not, SpringsNet is not empowered to make a decision. We will do additional research as needed. We'll survey citizens to the fullest possible extent. And then we've got decisions to make on whether or not we want to try to develop an RFP, try to approach a fiber optic project with a design build process, and then we want to do a thorough financial and risk analysis. From there, if we continue, we can identify, and continuing from there means that we're committed to move forward. Because once we commit to move forward with the project, then we can really step up to the table when it comes to developing strategic partnerships. Establishing governance structures, completing an engineering study, defining the service and the offerings that we would propose, selecting vendors to actually execute the work, establishing what our funding mechanism is going to be, and potentially selling bonds if it is determined that we would opt for a revenue bond to pay for the network. Then we go into the construction and installation phase. Keep in mind, up here, We've got a continuing marketing and sign up. After we've committed to moving ahead, we marketing and sign up for the service would begin as soon as possible so that we could ensure success. When we get to the construction installation phase, there would be a make-ready opportunity where we prepare the utility poles for fiber optic installation. This, by the way, would be an excellent opportunity to address the needs of the village with respect that exist today with respect to replacement of utility poles and repair of utility poles where needed. In fact, if you've already got money budgeted for the replacement of utility poles, you may be able to reallocate that someplace else if you were to proceed with a project like this. You would run cable, terminate, splice, test, install and configure electronics, initiate a support mechanism to provide ample support for the implementation, connect the subscribed premises, and initiate a billing process. Ongoing operations, we create an ongoing support structure. We address upgrades and maintenance on a regular basis. In the scenario that we've developed, we replace all equipment every 7 years. Now, that may or may not be necessary, but we don't want anybody to say we didn't plan for a replacement cycle, which is a good IT practice, any way you want to look at it. And then we look at possible expansion of service offerings, especially if we find that we're successful with the delivery of internet service. Ongoing marketing and ongoing evaluation of our success. And the final step here, as indicated on our slide, is that we've got a digitally empowered community. Go ahead. So why is this important? So we're living in what is commonly called, I got the term from the Intelligent Community Forum, which is an international think tank that focuses on modernization and bringing modernization to the rural areas, small communities, and cities and towns all over the world. But we're living in the new broadband economy. If you don't have fast access, just as you get on the road to drive to a store, and it's expected that that road would be provided, the road to the broadband economy, the road to the modern economy is across the public internet. Many people would contend, perhaps our local school superintendent for one, that internet access is the new civil right. It's critical, and really when it comes right down to it, what we're talking about is whether or not we're going to think about internet as strictly an entertainment service, or if we're going to think about it as a critical utility service, okay? So, economic factors, Yellow Springs, we understand where we've been. We understand that there's issues with the rising cost of living in Yellow Springs. There have been discussions about financial liabilities for landlords. There have been increases in electrical rates and water rates, property income tax increases, and lack of incentives to attract new business ventures. These are problems that every community in this region is grappling with. We are not unique in this sense. I will say that I think we all watched with interest the discussion and debate about the CBE. And one notable thing about that was one of the key criticisms of the initiative is that it wasn't a broadband connected. Now that wasn't 100% accurate, but the one criticism that was offered was that it was not a broadband connected development. Please go ahead. Here's the village goal, which I already read. Please go ahead. Intelligent communities. I've discussed intelligent communities a little bit, but attracting new business and creating jobs is really a critical factor for infrastructure development. Please go ahead. Um, So potential partnerships, when you embark on a project like this, a lot of people have interest in infrastructure development. I will tell you that Mbeka absolutely has interest in infrastructure development. There's also a data center with generator backup, dual service entry. This is all technical jargon, but there's a non-for-profit public agency that runs a data center right here in Yellow Springs. And they also happen to have big bandwidth fiber-based connections to multiple carriers. There's opportunities to share infrastructure. It's called shared sheath. You share the cost of construction, and then each stakeholder can get the strands of fiber that they need inside a sheath of fiber in order to reduce costs for everybody. So no one party has to pay for the cost of construction. Other municipalities may be potential partners. You could implement an open access model on the network, although as you'll see later, we don't necessarily recommend that because it does drain off revenue from an implementation. There are opportunities for public-private partnerships. There are fiber-to-the-home companies out there that will contemplate, assuming that the market draw is enough, building a fiber-to-the-home initiative. One of those is ACD, who is currently building a network in Springfield. And Mbeka is partnering with that organization in order to connect the schools with fiber. Last Mile Fiber is a Dayton-based organization, and Ting has been active in Westminster, Maryland. Go ahead. There are a bunch of successful fiber implementations. Okay, this slide here indicates, and we got this right from, I believe, the muninetworks.org. Over 450 U.S. cities have publicly owned fiber networks. One of the ones that you've certainly seen, Chattanooga, you know, there was an article that went around, I believe, that was circulated about the economic development locomotive that is fiber and its impact on Chattanooga, Tennessee. There are a bunch of other ones, but please go ahead. Leverett and Sandy, Oregon. Leverett, Massachusetts and Sandy, Oregon are two that we believe really closely resemble what we would like, it resembles closely what we would propose could happen in Yellow Springs. You'll see that there are some differences in populations, but as we'll talk about a little more, there are a bunch of similarities about their approach and their successes for these fiber implementations. Please go ahead. There are 89 specifically fiber to the premise networks in the United States. These networks are, as I say, fiber to the premise, fiber to the home. This, it goes beyond just serving business. We have extensive lists of these various networks, and we have a good bit of information about their successes, their failures, their downfalls, and their wins. Please go ahead. We have identified, as a result of our analysis, some critical factors for success. Manageable project scope. We believe that trying to proceed along a path where we would draw in, say, a dozen municipalities and try to do this in a very large way can cause a lot of problems. We saw an instance of that in the Northeast. So we believe that the project scope should remain manageable. We believe that the housing density in Yellow Springs is ideal. The houses are relatively close together, and that reduces costs when you're building fiber optics. We have our own electrical utility. We own utility poles. That's a big deal. That puts us far and above where other municipalities started. Municipal ownership is something that we strongly recommend, because then the municipality, public ownership of the resource, gives the municipality and its citizens the most bang for their buck, so to speak. Fiber optic technology is, of course, the preferred mode for the future. It is the gold standard in technology implementation. The thing with fiber is that you can push as much data as you ever want to across a piece of fiber, because by upgrading electronics that are connected to the fiber, as opposed to antiquated copper infrastructure that has limitations on how much data you can push across it. Of course, the Mavecca Data Center is a local bonus, and we have no legislative restrictions in Ohio on fiber to the home. Okay, so many states have legislative restrictions. Please go ahead. So, again, utility poles, multi-carrier data center. There are 1,597 village utility poles. 139 already have fiber on them, because we have done a good bit of fiber optic construction in the village. There's been we have one member of the SpringsNet group that has done an extensive amount of research just looking at our utility poles, where they're located, and what the current conditions are for, and that would lend themselves to a successful implementation. Please go ahead. Again, data speed capacity. While many people may currently be very happy with their ability to download Netflix on a Time Warner connection, there are distinct limitations. The day is gonna come when you don't always just download in order to fully participate in this broadband economy, you have to upload too. And that's the unique thing about fiber optics. You can achieve equal upload and download speed. You can move a massive amount of data. I can tell you that a kid on a smartphone can create files that are enormous, and then they want to move those files to another location. And that can be a very slow process if you're working on copper infrastructure. I'm just going to push right through. Please go ahead. This is a graph that was put or a chart that was put together to kind of demonstrate what is considered a quality internet connection. If you're here at the Bryan Center, you have a gig connection. If you're in a public school system, you have a gig. You have a robust internet connection that's fully synchronous. It has the same upload and download speeds. And that's a big deal if you are interested in high-def movies, Skype video calls. You know, these are things that are becoming more and more predominant. Please go ahead. Businesses, their bandwidth needs are much greater than residential, most regular residential users. When businesses are looking to invest in communities today, I can assure you that they're looking at their ability to connect, okay? There has to be fiber optic infrastructure available. They don't want to move into a facility and find out that there's an enormous build cost coming from Time Warner just so that they can get a fiber-based business class connection. Go ahead. So, in a moment here, I'm going to turn this over to Matt Cole to talk about the scenario that we've developed. Again, what we believe is possible is that we can offer a level of service that isn't even comparable to an AT&T or Time Warner service. It's not even the same thing. I will tell you that you should expect Time Warner to cut costs, AT&T to cut costs for service in this community if you opt to move ahead with an fiber optic implementation. That's a good thing. Those users that don't necessarily need a big bandwidth connection, don't want a big bandwidth connection, are happy with their service today, they'll see a decrease in cost. And that's wonderful. We fully expect that. We fully expect Time Warner to show up and make every effort to discourage you from making the move to publicly owned fiber optic infrastructure. But what we'll demonstrate is that for about the same price, maybe a hair more if you want a full gig connection, you'll be able to have a service that is 25, 100, 250 times faster than what you're consuming today. Please go ahead. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Matt Cole, And he's going to discuss the financial scenarios that we put together. Thank you.
How's it going so far?
All right. I'm going to do my best to stop talking in less than 4 minutes. So, before we get to this one, I want to skip to the last slide with the chart. I'm going to start with the very last slide of the presentation. That's sharp. Okay. So I just wanted to start with this, but first say a few words. Okay, the goal of the group was to present a plan, which is not the only plan for fiber optic network in Yellow Springs. The plan we'll talk about works where funds are received from a bond and from subscribers to build and fund the network that the village would own. So this is an ownership plan. Our financials show eventual profitability. And it's important to know that while the conservative projections and assumptions we made in the financials work, before proceeding, they need to be supported by the preliminary fact-finding that takes place before the financial commitment is made. And really, I'm just talking about that first column on that initial timeline chart there. In other words, the numbers really do need to get firmed up. We think we've been conservative, but of course, you know, before anything gets done, they need to get firmed up. We absolutely don't want anything that won't work financially for the village, of course. But we believe that there is a way for this to work. So there's just three parts of what I'm going to go through. First is the chart, and it shows three scenarios. What it is it's the chart of the fiber fund balance, and this would be an enterprise fund. And the whole goal of this, and I'm going to go through a couple of these assumptions that we made, or sort of rules, you know, when we went through this, is that the general fund was never touched. We wanted to look for a way where we could afford to do all this stuff, you know, build the fiber optic network and operate it, or, you know, in some fashion, keep it going, right? I'm saying we could contract a lot of services for that, not actually do them ourselves. But we wanted to find a way where we could do that without borrowing money from the general fund, or for operating costs or construction costs. And if you see these lines going up here, the green line represents a 60% take rate. That's where 60% of the village signs up for a subscription of some speed. The orange line is half the village, and the pink line is 40% of the village. Keeping this in mind, I'm just going to start going through some revenue assumptions, because there'll be revenue assumptions, you know, where did the money come from and how fast is it accumulating, and there'll be expense assumptions that we made that helped us get to this chart. So now we can go to the revenue assumptions. Okay, so revenue for that chart, to have it be the way that it was, you know, where there was never any dip into the general fund. Revenue includes 100 megabit subscribers, which would be like the standard service. 1 gigabit subscribers. Installation fees, equipment rental fees, and minimal immaterial direct Ethernet subscribers. And you know, I don't really know what that means exactly, but I know that it's a super fast thing that only special people pay a little bit more for. So there's a few people are going to be like that. Right? The second one here, 70% of the 1,800 households, which is the total population we used in our model, would get the 100 megabytes. 30% of the 1,800 households would get the 1 gigabyte. Fourth, there's a $75 installation charge. It's waived when villagers pay 3 months in advance during the construction period. So the idea was that, you know, if there were enough villagers that wanted this, and they put their money where their mouth is and pay 3 months in advance during the construction of this thing, the village would have more money sooner, and that would help pay back a bond, which would be funding the construction of the village, of the network. Next, repeat installation revenue associated with new installs due to households stopping and starting service as a result of moving in or out of the village with a new install are not accounted for at all. So if somebody were to be, you know, moving out of somewhere and then someone else moving in and they have to pay the $75 installation charge, we're not counting any of that money in the model. this is really important. Prices never change for the entire 20 years of life. So for 20 years, and some, there are models that work, and they're not that far-fetched, where the price never goes up for 20 years. It never goes up for 20 years. And I'm really talking about a $40 a month charge and a $5 a month equipment rental fee. And that's powerful, even on its own. The 60% take rate, a scenario where 60% of the village subscribes to some type of service, helps us pay off a bond, a 15-year bond instead of a 20-year bond. And we could even pay it off a little bit sooner than 15 years. Lastly, here, this last one, all equipment is triple play capable, but only internet revenues are calculated. So what this means is that because the network's in place and it exists, we can pump all these other things through it, not just in an internet service, but phone service or cable television service. It could be a lot of things because the network would be ours. Okay, next slide. Expense assumptions. The first one, of course, was kind of like our golden rule, is that it never went below zero. The fiber fund never went below zero. The bond term, we used a 20-year bond term and a 50 and 40% take rate scenarios because that's the depreciable life of the infrastructure. Third, emergency and recurrent support or contracted support is conservatively budgeted at $12,300 a month. Most of the numbers, anyway, were sussed out by the people that really know better. And we plugged them into this model. Melissa, we budgeted $4,000 a month to add help to your department, or administrative help of any kind, because I kind of thought, this is going to be more work for your department, but I know you're going to have your hands full anyway. So anyway, I just wanted to make sure that we mentioned that, $4,000 a month. All house towns, 1,800 of them, are fiber connected in the construction period by the same method. Electric is connected, assuming 30% burial and 70% aerial at $700 and $200 respectively. Wow, that's a mouthful, isn't it? What we're talking about is every household, these 1,800 households in the village, all getting connected right to the premises. Doesn't mean that they're going to become customers or not, but if they could, all it would be is really just a flip of the switch to connect them. It wouldn't be like, I want to, the local internet. Oh, we have to connect your house. No, you're already connected. All we have to do is turn it on. Thor's already mentioned that the equipment is replaced every 7 years. That's pretty important. All the equipment is triple play for 1,800 homes. We mentioned that. Installation costs include make-ready estimates for utility poles and are very conservative. No reduction in cost per household for high housing density or public ownership of utility bills has been calculated. So essentially, just to kind of bring it back up to the surface again, the revenue assumptions and the expense assumptions were pretty conservative. We felt like they were conservative. And I'm way over 2 minutes now. There was no way I was going to be 4 minutes. I'm sorry.
That's okay, Matt. I don't think anybody really expects.
All right. Okay, but I'm really almost done here. So there are plenty of variables in this financial model, and there are a lot of big moving parts. And when one thing gets affected, the bottom line gets affected. I think we should probably put it back on that final. Should we go through that?
No.
I think we can skip that. Right. We don't need to talk about that.
That.
Yeah, let's talk about that. Okay, so there's a lot of moving parts. And they are the total households to serve. Of course, that manages total population of potential customers and subscribers. I should call them subscribers. There's the total percentage of subscribers. And from that total, the percentage of households subscribing to 100 megabyte and 1 gigabyte service. So if half the village signs up for something, how many of that half is going to choose the 100 megabyte? How many choose the 1 gigabit? Because there are different prices for each, and that matters. Another variable is the bond amount, the interest rate, and the term of the bond. Another variable is the number of people that sign up and prepay 3 months during the construction period. This is an important detail. And, our model, we think that we made some conservative estimates about how many people would actually sign up and prepay. More money sooner really does make a difference when we're paying off the bond. And then the other variable is, of course, the total cost to install and build the whole network to all the households. That's a big variable too. And that all these things need to be sussed out in that first column. There has to be some preliminary firming up of all these numbers, which we think, you know, show a successful and profitable in the future working network. I think that's all I have to say for now. I think that our spreadsheet, I'll just end and just say that it's gone through a lot of, you know, and I'd like to talk to you about this in other places. So maybe in the future, you know, I'd love to, I think that it'd be good if you tried to break it, you know. That's important.
Okay.
That's it.
I think.
Good job.
Ellis, do you want to say a few words about the Lifeline program?
I'm happy to, if you want me to.
Yep. So, one other consideration that we have made is the affordability of this critical utility service for low-income residents. And we wanted to invite Ellis to say a few words about the Lifeline program.
And Ellis, is it okay if I put one little sentence in?
Put it in.
Just real quick. Just one thing to kind of explain about when you own an actual platform, like a cloud or whatever, these big companies that have these tools, and they oversubscribe people to it. So they don't actually have everything that they've offered, right? So what we're trying to say with a municipal platform, having your own network, is you get the power of the oversubscription. So you get all the extra strength that a normal company would just leverage for profit and be basically strip mining for profitability off of a dying infrastructure. So what you would have instead is the power to take that extra bandwidth or the extra connectivity and leverage it back to run. So you have the ability to run and redirect power to this kind of a program. I just wanted to frame that in.
Well, very quickly, people have heard this term digital divide. It's something we've been talking about ever since, Al Gore invented the internet. And, you know, the concept is that people that have money subscribe, you know, use the internet very well, much to their benefit, and lower income people don't. And in fact, all the recent surveys show that that's exactly what has happened. Middle class people, 90% of households have a broadband connection. Lower income people, less than half households have a broadband connection. And so, you know, the impact is significant. You want a job, you want whatever. It's hard to do it if you don't have a broadband connection at home. It's hard for the schools. The New York Times ran a big article recently about the homework gap. And my wife's a teacher, and I can attest to the fact that we have a homework gap in Yellow Springs. The kids get assignments, they need to do research on the internet, their parents want to check the thing that allows the parents to spy on their kids' school progress online. And if you don't have broadband at home, you're not doing that in the same way the other families are. And so it's a real issue. So the way that that has been addressed around the country is through the creation of a Lifeline program. Lifeline was originally a program created by the FCC, and it's been around for a long time, for phone service. So you can get a discount on the phone service to be connected to the phone. And just very recently, the FCC acknowledged the fact that it's not about phone service anymore, it's about broadband. And so we're going to make this Lifeline benefit available to broadband providers. And it would be available to Springsteen. Okay, so it's a $9.25 a month subsidy that the federal government will pay to subsidize a broadband connection for a low-income household. And the FCC has also been really trying to encourage broadband providers around the country to offer a very low rate for qualifying households. Qualifying households are kind of what you would expect, SSI, school lunch, SNAP, food stamps, and a few other programs. And so they've been encouraging companies to do it. For instance, two recent big mergers, AT&T and DirecTV, big merger condition the FCC put on it, you will offer a Lifeline program for $10 a month to low-income qualifying people. Another big merger you may have heard about, Charter bought Time Warner. There's a lifeline requirement in there, okay? The difference between the lifeline that the FCC is requiring of these big companies and what we could offer is that has a time limit on it. The AT&T direct merger commitment is just for 4 years. You gotta do it for 4 years and then you can do what you want. You don't have to keep doing it. Whereas we could have it an ongoing thing. The other thing that they really lack is an organic connection to the community that you're hoping will use this. AT&T and Charter know nothing about working with low-income folks. They do not have organic connections to the schools. We do. And in fact, if we have a lifeline program here in the village, there will be villagers that will, like, I would be one of them, would establish a nonprofit to get computers that would be refurbished and make sure that every low-income family in the village that wants one, gets the kind of training and access help they need to sign up for this program and take full advantage of it. So it's a real opportunity for us to address the equity issue at home, you know, here in the village. It's a real powerful tool for us. The other thing, it's an the affordability thing, I don't think we've quite fully addressed. You saw sort of the prices here. It's less than what you would, I mean, what you get is a whole lot more than what you pay the same money for from Time Warner or AT&T. But for me, for instance, like, I hate to admit it, but, like, you know, particularly in the winter, I'm pleading winter. I consume a lot of media, you know, Time Warner cable and HBO and all that garbage. And my bill is well over $100 a month that I pay for all that stuff. Well, for $40 a month, I plan on having SpringsNet, and I'm going to go over the top. I'm not going to be paying Time Warner or any of those people. And for $60 a month, I'm going to have every kind of media I ever need available. I'm going to save some money. So it's an affordability issue for middle-class people like me as well. So, you know, it's pretty good. And then when you add on the how critical this is for economic development, it really is. I mean, you hear, you know, companies talking about where do they want to be, how are they going to expand. They want a place where they got a big pipe to the internet. We can provide that. And because we're not going to, like, make a big fuss over who's residential and who's business, it's going to be real affordable for the businesses. I mean, like, real affordable to what they're presently paying. It's a big attraction. It's a magnet. So creating jobs, local jobs, all that stuff.
Thanks.
Oh.
You got to get started with the presentation.
That's it.
Very good. It was very informative. You guys did a very good job of keeping it a little bit low tech and understandable, and Matt, you did a good job.
Oh, thanks, Karen.
The numbers. So, council, do we want to just start peppering them with? Can we move all this?
Yeah,
stuff
get it out of the way. I feel, let's maybe we should
hug. Is it like of course. It's back home. I'll play euchre.
Get this out of the way.
He's already angry. I mean, you guys even, people could actually even move up a little closer to us if you want. But I mean, I don't know if we want to move the whole
room.
Should
we get on our knees? Like,
yeah, well, yes, everybody sit in the
I'm just
in the front of the circle.
Let's sit in the circle.
Yeah.
I'll sit here.
So Susan can get the back of your head.
It's okay.
So, council, I assume we all have questions. How do we want to start? Just
one question.
Yeah, I mean, or do we want to start with staff or council?
Let's start with council.
Okay. Judith, question?
I want to understand what happened in Burlington, Vermont.
Who can speak to that?
Okay, so you're getting to the questions about failures of municipal broadbands, and Burlington is one of the biggest. Basically, it came to a lot of political infighting, operational mismanagement, the change in administration, the mayor. There was also some outright taking money that the administration didn't really have authority for, and so basically it's, you know, defaulted on some bonds. And I heard in one of the papers I read, Citibank wanted to rip the fiber off the poles and get it back, but of course that's not practical. So let me just qualify that. I call it a failure, but it's still operating. And they're still trying to find a way to get it to work.
But haven't they had to sell it?
I'm sorry, what?
My understanding was they had to sell.
They had to sell it? Yeah, that's one of the options they're trying to work on, but they have to meet whatever their bond arrangements are. So it's not, it's still operating. People are still using it. It hasn't shut down.
What are the lessons learned from
that? You basically want to make sure that when you do a plan, you really think through what you want, you don't overbuild, you don't, you know, you have transparency, you have active project management, and, you know, we're much smaller than Burlington. And also, this collapse of the system actually occurred during the Great Recession, and that's when all the money started, and people had to come to do with, you know, come to the banks and make payments and stuff, and they weren't doing it. Does that answer?
Well, I guess I like, so they got the bonds, mm-hmm. and they built it, and the people came and bought it, bought the service. And I'd like to know a little bit more detail. I heard what you
there's
said,
great,
but I still don't really
there's
understand.
There's a great 20 to 30 page paper on it. I'll be glad to share it with everyone.
But is there some lessons that we need to learn? Are there?
Yeah, you have to make sure that this is the network that we're going to build. I mean, we're a very defined area. We're not that big as Burlington, as many population. And I didn't really look at the density, but we have a better ratio. And we don't have, I've never been to Burlington, so I don't know what the geography is.
I think through
it
the
It appears pretty dense as well, where I was at.
But, you know, by the way, so that's one of the most notable one, along with Utopia. But these are bigger projects. They're dwarfing. This is something in the area of, I think, 30 to 40 million, and Utopia is even up near 100 million. These are big, 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 big projects. We're not even trying to get, we're not dealing with that big a size. Is that?
Well, I don't know. I guess I'll have to look into it a little bit more. I just want to
understand the level of
there,
risk.
One issue that
it doesn't sound like from the presentation there's any risk at all. It sounds
No.
Right.
And so I'm a little skeptical, but maybe
no,
it's
no,
true.
No.
But you know,
no,
I just
there is risk in anything. I mean, we're going to have to make a case to borrow the money, and the bond Matt can tell whatever their name is. The bond guarantees
or
bond council is going to have to say, "Yep, this is what we want to do." And whoever's going to loan the money is going to say, I think they've done their homework. We'll give you this interest.
And they'll probably have to back it. We'll have to back it up potentially with...
We'll pay back with our revenue and proper management. By the way, I wanted to add to what Thor said. He said, every 7 years we replace the equipment. He meant every 7 years we replace the electronic equipment. We don't replace the fiber. The fiber is warrantied for 20 to 30 years.
I think it's warranted for 30 years, actually.
But practically speaking, the original fibers that they put into different municipalities as good as the day it was put in there. I mean, 40 years ago. I mean, fiber optic cables have been going underneath the ocean for over 30 years. All the transcontinental, transoceanic cables are fiber.
So I think that we can follow up with you on
yeah.
Burlington and get you a much more comprehensive answer. And if we suggested that there's no risk, I think that would be incorrect. There's certainly a risk with any endeavor. I would say that the biggest risk is that we wouldn't get the subscription rate that we need in order to make the implementation successful. What we see as we look at these various projects is that the risks are addressed by good old-fashioned hard work and effort to make us to drive the implementation home and to make the service offering successful. Marketing is going to be key. Understanding the market is going to be key. And having an excellent price point and a good financial plan are going to be key. Making sure that the engineering and the construction fall into budget. That was one thing I know that happened in Burlington is they went over budget on their construction, and I think it put them in the hole right off the bat.
It was also over-designed. Overbuilt, and therefore it became too costly to operate and maintain. And then you add an economic, the Great Recession, along with other things going on. It was already on the edge, and then
the Great Recession didn't help it. But it's still operating.
And I would add, when you talk about risk, consider the risk of not doing anything. There's a risk there too. There's always risk in whatever we choose to do. So I view not improving our infrastructure as a risk as well.
If I can chime in real quick. So subscribers, what Thor mentioned, if you guys remember, you guys are experts at looking at charts. That one chart that Matt had up, if you saw the 40 line on the bottom, I don't know if any of you noticed that the 40 line went up at the end and it crossed over the 50, which is kind of weird.
Yeah.
But there's a reason why on the assumptions, we had to go in, if it hits 40, we have to actually change on our 20-year price lock. So we have levers that we can move. We're not stuck, you know, having to promise it's going to be the same price forever. All Matt did in looking at the model, and we're going to give the model to Melissa so she can, again, tool through it. But if you take that 40% version, we only get 40% of the village, with some of them being 100, some of them being a gig, and you increase their rate after 5 years and after 10 years, very modestly.
Like $3 a time.
Yeah, and then 15 years, there's actually no dipping in. It actually goes up above the 50% take rate. So we're not like subject to fate here. If we start this off, we can start moving some of the offerings, some of the pricing, and I think, you know, we're not sitting ducks.
Let's keep going around the table.
More questions.
Okay. Focus, you got one question.
Yeah. Okay, first of all, I very much support moving forward with studying this, and I'm looking at, you know, your table here. So you've indicated you've completed this first sort of 18-month preliminary study. You have a next section of preliminary study. That's all. That is what you're suggesting. So I see very little risk in moving forward with studying it. I mean, there's certainly staff time that we need to consider, and there may be some funds.
That's actually something they didn't address.
But regardless, so my question is about creating the advisory board. I don't really know how SpringsNet got formed, but my sense is that the SpringsNet, I don't know if you're thinking it would morph into the advisory board. I mean, council, I assume, would create the board. So I'd like to know what your thinking is about the advisory board, when you would suggest creating it, who would be on it, anything you have to say about that.
Matt, do you want me to address that?
Sure.
From our conversation?
Yes, yeah.
Matt and I, and Doug was also there, we actually had a conversation today about this, and my suggestion was that if council chooses to move forward with this, the indication that I got, and maybe I misunderstood, but was that SpringsNet wanted to step back and assume that advisory capacity so that, and let the village take the lead in doing the feasibility study, perhaps the engineering study, that kind of thing. So my suggestion to Matt was that SpringsNet, if that's the case, become the village manager's advisory board, which is a board similar to the one we used in the police chief search, where it's a board out of my office, not necessarily the board of council, but they work with me in an advisory capacity to help me present council with what you ask for. And I think that's probably why you phrased it the way that you did. And then SpringsNet would act in that capacity.
I also just wanted to say how much I appreciate what you all have done. And I mean, it seems like we are so fortunate to have you here, and the array of skills and background that you have is like, wow.
Thank you.
May I ask one quick thing? The answer to many questions, as you'll see as we proceed, is how do you want it? We want to continue to work with the village council to customize a plan that will meet your every need. You know, we want to make it the best possible plan out there, the best, and create the best possible implementation. So we can create an advisory board. We can bring resources to the table. We have a lot of expertise. There's a great deal that we can do. But we're interested at this point in simply working together.
Jerry?
What percentage of the household sector versus the business sector have demanded this need for the high speed, number one? And then number two, given that two of our competitors are AT&T and new Time Warner entity, what is, when we look at their percentage of subscribership within the village?
That's a good one.
So the business retention survey in 2009, actually there were comments made about the need for better telecommunications and more affordable telecommunications and dissatisfaction with the two existing incumbents, AT&T and Time Warner. So
that was 2009?
I believe it was 2009.
And has technology improved since 2009?
Absolutely. As a matter of fact, that actually kind of jumps on the point about Burlington or Utopia. Those projects started in 2001 and 2002. We're 15 years past that. Fiber as a commodity has been used much more widely across everywhere. So therefore the technology is much more affordable and it's not strictly big business, government, etc. But as far as the potential risk from the incumbents that are here, there's an article, a great article about what to expect when a community wants to do their own municipal broadband. And they've already taken step one. They've contacted the village manager. And they've, the second part, as I understand, they contacted you last week.
We met with Time Warner.
You met Time Warner?
No, Time Warner, we met with.
We met with Time Warner. Don't worry, AT&T's coming next. No, and of course.
They refused to talk to us.
Pardon me?
They refused to talk to us.
No, and Time Warner actually said that AT&T probably won't.
Yeah. But you know,
do anything.
Going back to another more local case like Lebanon, Ohio, the next step will be spreading disinformation, you know? You guys don't know what you're doing. The village does not know what we're doing. But I think we got a plan where we are maximizing on partnerships with another governmental organization, as well as, to the maximum extent, contracting out the expertise. And that's what Leverett, Massachusetts, and Princeton, Massachusetts have done.
But that was not the question.
Pardon me?
I'm going to answer your question. Just briefly. Right. I think that, okay, so the second part of your question was about AT&T and Time Warner, and what percentage of them would be serving the village.
No, my question was, what is the percentage of the folks that live here in Yellow Springs, subscribe to one of the two? You know, that's what my, you know, because if we're looking at 40%, that we need, we kind of have something.
This is actually there. This was actually answered in the original white paper to an extent. It's not divided into businesses versus residential. But Time Warner, 55.04% of the village has Time Warner. 35.15% has AT&T. 5.99% say they don't have internet, and 3.81% say they have other.
Was that from the survey?
This is in their original white paper.
But that was from the survey.
That was a survey.
Yeah. So to be taken with a grain of salt.
35% of the village responded.
Probably most of the village has some service from one of those two.
But that should be pretty easy to get, right?
Yeah. The Pew Center for the Internet Study, on the national average, it's 80%.
We of course don't have the exact number, but we could do a more extensive survey if that's the direction that you
would want to go. 40% of something.
Right. Yeah. This is I both of you had similar things to say, and this really kind of falls into the next column of things about, you know, firming up these numbers. You know, those questions speak directly to firming up. You know, how many subscribers, or just you know, said that if there's going to be any kind of shortfall, it's going to be because of the number of subscribers.
I would add that Uni Networks has surveyed all of the municipal fiber to the home networks, and approximately 55% is the average take rate of all those networks.
Will we be different?
Brian?
Yes. So I appreciate laying out a path forward. That's very helpful. I want to ask a little bit about, there was a lot of emphasis on the assumptions and the financials being conservative, and if you could talk a little bit about some of the more practicalities.
Doug, you want to say a few words? Doug hasn't said much. I'm going to turn.
Sorry.
I'm on the spot. In the FAQ that we distributed, we did reference a study that indicated that back in 2009, the estimated cost per household for a fiber to the home implementation was around $1,309 on the high end. Okay, our estimate is well above that at $1,385. We also have utilized figures for backbone construction that assume the engagement of a engineering firm and project management firm that would have a fee. We don't have to take that approach. There are lots of options to really reduce engineering costs and reduce some of the planning, the costs associated with the planning stages, in order to drive down the cost in the model. So those are the two most immediate examples of conservative estimates that I can think of in our model. Does anybody?
It would never be done this way, but there will be bond issuance costs, right? And instead of adding them to the bond amount and then rolling that into a total payment, I just took them right off the top. So the net from the bond proceeds is less than in these financial models. So that was a. And it's 5%.
And you guys are also assuming a full build out, right? Yes. So we don't have to go that route.
That is correct. No, you don't have to. Absolutely not. You can do a staggered rollout. It would save some of the upfront costs. But of course, if you address everything in the construction phase all at once while there are construction firms in town, then of course there would be a savings associated with taking that approach as well.
And a footnote on that, the network device, if we only have a subscription rate of 40 or 50,
yeah,
55.
You can take a look at this. This is the
device that would be in everybody's home.
It's called an ONT. It's a network terminal. It would be approximately that size. It's also got built-in wireless capabilities.
Are you done, Brian? Mm-hmm. I've got so many questions. I mean, I'm honestly much less skeptical than I've been than I've appeared in the past. My questions are probably a little too specific. I'm trying to think. Okay, so explain. Okay, so let's use one of our streets. Let's use West South College as an example. We're going. So there's a fiber line going down the street, hanging from the pole. So what's the process of it getting to the house, and who's paying for that wire, for that fiber to get from that pole into the house? Is that what the homeowner's paying for?
No.
So
that is all included in the construction cost estimate.
So
everything to the house.
So we're going to make a decision, or the idea is to make a decision to go ahead and say, let's say, use the number 1800, to just make those 1800 connections, whether those people want it or not.
Correct.
There would have to be an opt-out process for homes that absolutely did not want it.
We
can't force somebody to run a fiber cable to their house.
So you're saying that they wouldn't, so it would be. So there wouldn't necessarily be a fiber to an individual home, but then you could come back, a new homeowner, somebody changes their mind. They could
disconnect it.
No, they could add it.
That's the idea. The always 1800 are going to be there. Everyone gets connected.
But what she's saying is if there's none in place, someone comes in and they want to request it, we can splice that off and bring it right to the home and set them up. But that's a burden on the next homeowner to have to pay potentially, because I don't know that we would bill that, you know, 5 years from now and just.
Well, the way the financial model was built was to run it to all 18 homes. What Tim was saying is, if you want to come to my home and I'm like, you ain't coming on my property, then the cable is not going to be run to your house. And if somebody doesn't say that, it's going to 1,800 homes.
Okay.
So, and then when they say,
and
they,
then they,
when they want to be
spending
a customer,
$75 to buy that box.
No.
Right, right. The box would be the $75
well,
process.
Well, if they did the pre-construction, that would be.
And good. All of Yellow Springs is fiber ready.
The box is placed only when they turn on the actual internet service.
Right. So it's just like you get your cable box.
Exactly.
Or
it's equivalent to a cable.
Correct.
Right. Yeah, but so again, that gets plugged in that cable that was run.
But that's this model, right? That
yeah, this
another model could
right,
be
right.
We only run it if you sign up, right?
Right. There are some
right, and that would save a pile of money. But then it would be long term. It would cost later, maybe
right.
more, to bring those guys back to go, oh, you didn't want it the first time around? We were in the neighborhood installing these big backbone on the poles, right? But now you do. Okay, well, it's a little more now.
Yeah. There's data out there, a lot of speculation about, but I would say the average I've heard is around 5% value to the home has increased if you have a fiber connection. Real estate agents love it.
Okay, Patty?
I think I'd like to go last. So that was the
I just had a question about the 1800 that's being referenced, because I know that we send 2200 utility bills out, so. But we do have apartment complexes and numerous tenants in one building. So the 1800, is that just a connection to an individual building then, regardless of the number of tenants inside? Is that?
I think that's true, but I think there could actually be more individual accounts than 1800. We would have to come up with a various scheme to handle apartment buildings, and there's various ways to do that.
But we'll be conservative. It turns out to be quite complex to answer a question like how many houses, how many places are there to which you would attach fiber. The Greene County Auditor's Office has a database that has 1,888 unique addresses, which accounts for the fact that, you know, we have people who have a house that's on multiple lots or multiple parcels. You can't count parcels. And that also takes into account the multi-dwelling apartment units that have unique addresses, but that's imprecise as well. So
I'm just wondering if that 2,200 figure could skew things, because I know that we send 2,200 utility bills out.
Which
so I'm just wondering.
Probably the closest number
yeah.
is probably a closer number.
No, that would just help.
Well, that's better.
Yeah.
Well,
we actually that would give us a larger number of potential consumers of the service. But we actually had a lot of debate about the right number and. Frankly, we settled on a number that was as close as we could get to the right number, knowing that, you know, if we add more subscribers, our initial costs will go up, but our potential revenue streams will go up as well. And then if it's less, the same is true.
So,
let me add on to Thor's question, this comment about 2,200. So you actually include in those accounts, those also include like the lights that are in the backyards. Are those separate accounts?
Those are separate accounts.
See?
Actual electric.
Right.
Electric.
And also the electric service extends beyond the village boundary, correct?
No, it doesn't.
The poles do.
The poles do, but the electric service doesn't.
So, okay.
Like Gold Willow Court.
Right.
They don't have.
Okay. But in any case, the other source for where we got the 1800 beyond the Greene County Auditor is that's what the U.S. Census says.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, so housing survey. That's why.
That says. I shouldn't say houses. It says 1800 households.
Yes. Right. You can think of it this way. It actually says households, like Dan said. But the thing to think of is, for instance, the building downtown that houses the. Place where I think you get your haircut, and the urban handmade, and then there's apartment above it. So it's one unique address, but there are actually three potential users there, because there are three accounts that get mailed a bill.
But actually, if you have an apartment building, it's cheaper, right?
Yeah.
I mean, ultimately, I mean, isn't that the idea? I mean, on average, because you're running it from the pole, but then just a short bit of fiber to get to all those apartments.
Right.
So
that's,
I want to respond to your question and say that it would be best to find out exactly how many there are. I mean, if you're billing at 2,200, right, maybe there'd be 2,200, it'd be a bigger population. And as far as the firming up of all of these numbers, you know, that's a number that has to be firmed up. And that's probably one that's within our control. You know, something like how many of them are going to subscribe to the 100 megabyte service, maybe not as easy to figure out. But that's like one that it would be best to figure that out.
And besides, and yeah, you know, we actually knew the accounts and the addresses, and we also know which ones are aerial and which ones are buried. And that's, a, you know, because buried is 2.5, 3, almost 3 times more expensive, you really want to know, where are those buried lines? And are these buried lines, is it 100 feet or is it 1,000 feet? That's going to make it beyond 3-4 times. It's going to make it much more expensive. Leverett in Princeton, Massachusetts, they say first 100 feet's on the network. After that, it's the homeowners. Because 1,000 feet, they the person I've talked to out there has like a quarter mile driveway. It's all buried. So I don't think we have too many quarter mile driveways, but.
You have any other questions, Melissa?
Judy, do you have any questions?
Me?
Yeah. You're allowed. Nope. Mr. Burns?
Well, I'm like you, Karen. I got a bunch. One thing I want to ask is after the fiber has been running, you got an estimated cost for 2 full-time employees with $30,000 in benefits. Which, where's that money coming from? And is your customers or the customers calling and raising Cain with the utility department? Because if Time Warner has an outage, it's like they did 2 Sundays ago, me and my guys have to come in because we got systems ain't working in town and all that. So we, where's the cost?
I think the idea you'd be off the hook.
Yeah, so what we did kind of skip, we were trying to hurry and get through the presentation so we weren't continuing in lecture mode. But we've got other assumptions associated with support, including 24-hour help desk and you know, other support functions like that. So there would be somebody to answer the phone. It wouldn't necessarily fall to you. It wouldn't necessarily be handled like the electrical services, where after hours you call the police dispatch. But it could be handled that way, and really that's a kind of a how do you want it question. If there are efficiencies associated with helping you staff up and help, you know, or helping train, you know, provide, say, some limited training for the infrastructure, fiber splicing training and things like that, there might be great efficiencies there associated with developing that skill set. In the FAQ, we talked about a hybrid approach where we contract out initially, we train up, and then we absorb the support function in order to save money. Now, with respect to the cost of those employees, that's all included in the initial bond purchase and in the ongoing revenue model.
Patty?
On the page in your PowerPoint from tonight on socioeconomic factors. I don't understand how some of them relate. So if someone could address how the fiber network relates to the landlord financial liability, the increases in water and electric, and the property and income tax. How do those things relate to the fiber network?
It's all about really the rising cost of living, and those are just examples of you know, where the cost is going up. And we view that the solution to that is raising the taxable base of business in the village.
Okay.
And we think the fiber network, it's as simple as attracting more entrepreneurial ideas and companies that will contribute to the tax base.
So you're assuming that the expansion of the consumer base will offset these other things?
Well, yes, and I mean, we could attract, just like big mailing service, well, what did that do to help alleviate the financial pressures put on low-income families in the village? You know, they pay more property taxes, they pay more income tax. Mm-hmm. So that's a way out of that dilemma. I mean, it doesn't take much to go on social network sites these days and find a lot of complaints about the low income status of people in this village. And we just view it as a way to alleviate that. Maybe it wasn't clearly stated enough, but it's not directly related, but it's a way to solve that issue.
Okay, it says what problems are we trying to solve, and I just didn't understand how the fiber network related to these things. So you're saying that the expansion of the consumer base as far as increasing the number of users in the village.
Well,
I think
it's basically business attraction. I think what he's suggesting is business attraction.
But the not so much residential, but even residential, when you consider that somebody's going to be spending less money for their internet service,
ideally
they could put more money into other businesses in the village as well.
There would also be a new and interesting opportunity for home-based workers to set up home offices and, you know, create entrepreneurial opportunities. I know I've spoken personally to many, many people who are trying to run home offices across a traditional infrastructure and not having a very good time with it.
But I did also hear Ellis say that, I mean, here's a bill that we could lower, right?
Right, yeah.
So
that's true too. It is, because once they start, if it does become profitable into the future, then you know this excess cash has to go somewhere. That's a Ohio Revised Code issue, perhaps, for this enterprise fund, right? You know, but it actually, I don't know how this would work, but could it go back to the subscribers in it as a credit or something for the following year? I mean, what to do with the profit after it's used to pay, make another principal payment on the bond? You know, and then after the bond is gone, what to do with all the profit?
Right.
You know, make the bill go down, maybe.
Yeah.
Use it to maintain the network another way.
That's something that's been discussed a lot, is the idea that we could develop models that are both fit. Yeah. And we could do
anything. Oh, hi! Whoa!
We could develop models that are revenue neutral. We could develop models that are revenue positive as well. And so that would be a good problem to have.
Yeah, we just
I got to tell you the idea that it's 20-year flat rate. I mean, we're now suffering from rate increases because we weren't raising utility fees. So I'm, no matter what, even if it's able to be paid for, I'm not inclined to keep a flat rate for any utility, just because our costs are going to go up.
Sure.
Labor costs are going to go up, material costs are going to go up. So, and I would assume that if you know, we could take those increases and just pay the bond off earlier.
Yeah that's sure. right. That's what
it is.
Yeah.
Judith, do you have more?
If we get enough people signing up sooner.
Yeah, I'm curious about the legislative restrictions that some states have put into place, and do they ever put them in after? So I'm curious what's happening in the state of Ohio, and also how that could affect if some restriction was put in place after the system's put in place. If that's happened in other states and what that looks like.
In most cases in other states, the existing networks were grandfathered in if legislation was passed after the fact. I don't know of any exceptions to that rule. There may be, but
What is the legislation?
Legislation prohibiting municipal networks.
Really?
Yes.
Are you serious?
Oh, there's multiple states. There's 20 some.
Can I jump in? There's 22 states that have, after a municipal network was established in the state. I'll take Tennessee because of Chattanooga and all the other. They have, I think, six or seven. The state legislature said, nope, you can't do this anymore. We need to protect the citizens' money. We don't want them to waste money on saving money and broadband. And in Colorado, I don't know how many systems they had, but they can't shut it down once they've been up and running. But they actually allowed the local town or county to override their wishes, the state wishes, which is not to allow you to have control of your telecommunications. And over 50 cities and towns and districts voted to restore their rights to do that.
So what's going on in the state? Is there anything happening in Ohio?
We talked to a member from the Commerce Department of the state of Ohio last year, and she indicated that there was absolutely no interest in doing that. And the governor is very pro-municipal network, at least at the present time. Could easily change.
The current governor is, in fact, pro-infrastructure development, specifically with fiber. Mobeka was awarded a local government innovation fund loan, which, as you know, is relatively competitive in, to build infrastructure in Wilmington. And that came directly from the Department of Development. So the trend is positive right now, but I don't think you can dismiss the risk. We must be realistic about it. Back in the early 2000s, AT&T lobbied the state legislature to such an extent that they took away the municipalities' rights to negotiate their own cable franchise agreements. And we're feeling the fallout from that right now. Yellow Springs no longer gets to negotiate for its own cable franchise agreement. That basically made AT&T's entry into the entertainment market easier as they wanted to expand their cable offering. So we know these large telecommunications providers can absolutely put the pressure on. But I would say that striking while the iron's hot and then remaining vigilant on those issues is going to be important.
How is it then that some states, and Tennessee is certainly one, had a number of communities that got this system, and the state of Washington, I guess, is, were there particular things that the state was doing to support it, or?
There's parts of that was the states were supportive of them doing the municipal broadbands, but also many of them took advantage of the American Recovery Act. There's a program called BTOP, B-T-O-P, Broadband Technology Opportunity Program, I believe, something to that effect. And so that's when a lot of the things were done in Tennessee, Washington. Mm-hmm. And if you look at that map, a lot of those areas are very, particularly in Appalachian areas, they're very depressed. The textile mills are gone. And for many of these towns, this was, we got to do something.
And I would add that the federal government, at least with the current administration, is very supportive of these endeavors. And in fact, I just got an email today from the NTIA, Department of Commerce, applauding us for trying to give this presentation tonight. And I think there's maybe some new programs and possibilities for grants from the federal government.
Jerry?
Timeline. I see where we're at, and what I'm seeing here is it says that once we move forward within 11 months, we're gonna be done.
Could happen. It's possible.
This is what it's telling me. Now, is that realistic? See, because it took us 18 months to get here. Some is up to us, but some is up to them also, because we're just going to be nodding our heads.
Well,
and then,
no.
See,
no.
Because...
No.
Let me finish, okay?
Yeah.
Because I see a three-month time frame in the next iteration.
Sure.
That all these tasks are going to be done. Now, granted, they can be done concurrently or whatever, but are you putting me on a track that all I can do is shake my head?
I would hope not. We don't want any rash decisions made. We want the deliberation. We want the discussion. We want the analysis. However, once you decide that this is the direction you want to go, I think that there are a lot of resources that can be brought to bear to make a project come to fruition very quickly. Fiber is not a long, drawn-out construction process. You can build fiber very quickly. I actually have a contractor right now that's swearing that he's going to run 15 miles worth of fiber optics in 3 weeks' time. So that's pretty significant. So it does depend a lot on how the council chooses to proceed and when the council reaches that point where they become comfortable. Dan, did you have something?
Yeah, I was going to, so let's use an Ohio example. Fairlawn, Ohio, in January 2015, they were at this point, are we going to do it or not? The mayor submitted an ordinance. They agreed. This May, last month, they actually started digging. Now, their schedule shows, they're about two to three times the size of Yellow Springs. Their schedule shows 3 years to complete the whole project. So roughly a year and a half. And then that's from the shovels pulling. They're saying 3 years or 2 years at least, I believe. So I'll just use that. That's reality. They're doing it right now. They're doing the whole fiber to residences and businesses. My research on the other places, there's always problems, and it never goes as smooth. With good planning, you minimize those problems, but you can't eliminate them. There's no perfect or riskless project if you want to achieve something that's going to be very important for the next 30 years. Faster is better, but no one can guarantee.
But just to be clear, excuse me, what's not timed on this are the green blocks, how long it's going to take council to make the decision, which I understand that you guys won't, you know, how are you going to predict that, right? This timeline is how long to do the build out, the study.
Okay. It's really more of a chronology, in truth, than a, you know, let's nail down this timeline.
The estimates are estimates.
Right. So my question, though, is for the next step, if we do move forward, the preliminary study piece, what's the estimated cost, do you think, to do that engineering study and that sort of thing?
Yeah, where's that come from?
Okay, so there are several approaches. We did budget $150,000 just for a flat-out study where we hire an outside firm to come in and do everything, okay? We can immediately go to construction firms right now today and start accumulating and doing a design build process, which is a process that saves a lot of money, but it also allows a construction firm to survey the area, provide a bid, and find their own efficiencies in their construction process. And sometimes, you know, creating an RFP and going through that process can be limiting to a construction firm. So there's that to consider. This is one of those, how do you want it? Because we would want to know how you would prefer to proceed, and we can make some recommendations, but we can go two routes on that.
I feel like you're getting ahead of yourself, though, because you're talking about jumping right into engineering. We've already talked about some preliminary information that we need. Our staff cannot do that on their own. So there's going to have to be some sort of a consultant scenario set up. And I like you guys. You guys have done great work, but you're not unbiased people. And so I would prefer us that we hire a consultant that would do the work. And I think, you know, Patty's thinking that you would be on an advisory board, staff would be interacting, and that would be the next step. So I don't even know what kind of consultant it is. I don't, you know, that's, so explain that to us. What is this next step?
Well, our estimates came from OFS, and you did, we're there to hear Jeff Thumma speak, if you recall. He could be our man, with respect to, moving this project ahead. But we did create our estimates based on numbers that we received from him. And he's done many fiber to the home projects. But
isn't there a step? I mean, I'm not comfortable with SurveyMonkey.
We need a,
so we need a broader user survey. We need to understand the current subscription rates in the community. There's just a lot we need to understand before we even consider engineering. Right. To get a firmer, I mean, we need a firmer price, a firmer estimate on the construction.
Right. This is really, I think, the most important thing right now, maybe, is to firm up all these numbers, to sort out this 1,800 figure, to how much is it really going to cost?
Right.
You know, how many people are really going to subscribe at what lever, level?
So how does that get done?
I think the first thing that, if council really wants to see more information on this, I think the first thing we need to do is find someone to do a feasibility study, which requires letting an RFP, because we're a government agency and it's going to be more than $15,000 probably, and we're going to have to bid it out. So, you know, I think that if that's what council wants to see, then we need that. That's the first step, is a feasibility study, an actual feasibility study that should include a complete survey of the potential users in the village to find out what is the take rate going to be, because that's very important.
But part of the problem with that is that if you haven't done any marketing, which you haven't, then you're really not going to know. So I'm not sure that's very helpful. If the marketing is going to happen through the schools, the newspapers writing positive articles, and, you know, we're selling the idea to the citizens, you're going to get a very different number than just doing something right this minute.
We kind of hit a wall as far as how much we could do in that space, as far as, you know, how far you can go with reaching all these people and saying, or asking them to commit, or, you know, we couldn't take money or do any of those things, which would be a real telltale.
I'm not an engineer, I'm just a librarian. So in Hudson, Fairlawn, they did basically a fiber engineering study, and roughly, the figure is roughly $50,000. And you have to, they have a whole process doing it. People in Massachusetts do it that way. And it's a reasonable investment. I think also if the council commits, then also Tim and I have already talked with Yellow Springs Community Foundation. Maybe we can get some money as seed for that.
Well, and I agree that needs to be done. I think both the feasibility study and the engineering study need to be done, and maybe they go hand in hand, and you let the RFP together, you know, as
right.
one consultant. But you need the answers to both of those
right.
things to make an informed decision.
I agree totally. And by the way, virtually every one of these fiber engineering studies use the online software tools, SurveyMonkey, and that's actually what we borrowed from different SurveyMonkeys to put our informal pulse together, which actually was statistically reasonable. It wasn't totally random, but it was, you know, 364 replies is 364 adults in Yellow Springs is not a trifling number.
Well, it's very significant.
Yeah.
Once you get 300 data points, doesn't matter how many more you get.
So, Patty, do you have more questions?
No, I think I'm just looking
in
information right now.
Johnny?
I see
the 1,597 poles, 139 already have fiber. Have you guys had any conversations with AT&T about the 450-something poles that we actually write on them? Because if not, that's more poles that you have to figure in. Because I can't imagine AT&T allowing fiber to go on their poles when there's a chance that they're going to be losing business as well.
Are
they using our poles?
AT&T's not using our poles though, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes, they are.
Are they?
Well, so that's maybe there's a leverage point there.
Well, yeah, I think his point is that they may not have included those in.
Right.
Their analysis.
Also, well, what Johnny's bringing up is a very big issue, is what's called make ready. And Johnny can give you more of the technical terms. Basically, any attachment between the power and the telephone line, and correct me, Johnny, if I'm wrong, it has to be attached properly. And so the way that works is each one of the companies or the owners of the attachments, they get the, before you say put the fiber on, the other attachees on there have to be, well, I'm going to move it when I get around to it. Although there's a little bit more to that. But in Louisville, they have what's called a one-touch make-ready. So whoever, and this is a legislation thing, they want, you know, who's qualified to do this, can do the you know, instead of having two, three trucks move the wires, whatever they are, you only have one.
Now, what I'm bringing up is SP or AT&T owns these poles, and we have permission to ride on them.
Right.
Have you guys talked to AT&T about putting village-owned fiber on their poles to eliminate their service?
Well, we're not going to eliminate their service.
No.
We're going to set up a service parallel to it. I would simply...
Your goal or the village goal is to have everybody on the village fiber, correct?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so that's what I'm saying. You are trying to take SBC's or AT&T's spot. So that's why I'm saying you may get a pushback from AT&T.
And by the way, that's what happened in Louisville where this legislation went in and Google Fiber went in. Louisville is being sued by AT&T. They do not want Google Fiber to go on AT&T poles.
Okay, so it doesn't get buried.
In Ohio, the Public Utilities Commission does have a set of rules that require companies like AT&T to provide access to their poles. I don't know what the financial arrangements are, but you can't just deny access. You have to provide the access, but maybe charge for it.
That's right. You have to go through a standard permitting process. In order to get an attachment on the pole, AT&T would come back and say, and perhaps provide do their own pole engineering, unless you're a preferred contractor. Some preferred contractors do have standing agreements with these telecommunications carriers in order to do their to make ready and engineering pole engineering themselves. But you put to go through a permitting process. You tell them that you're going to make an attachment, and then they generally charge you something, and then you proceed with the attachment. Now granted, it is going to be an interesting question, you know, but what I know about AT&T, I mean, AT&T's never asked me why I wanted to hang fiber optic cable on a pole when I've gone through permitting processes. Now if they decide that, you know, if they become savvy and they become informed about our initiative, I don't know, who knows, but again, the Public Utilities Commission would be an entity to turn to.
But if you don't have a pole, you bury it, right?
Yep.
There's always an option to bury it.
Okay, so that might be a little more expensive, that's why we need to
engineer. But I'm assuming this isn't a long line of poles. I'm assuming they're dotted through town, so you don't go, I mean, is that true, Johnny?
Yeah.
AT&T owns all the ones on Dayton and all the ones on West South.
One after the other.
Okay, well, that does make a difference. I mean, I'm thinking that they just own certain poles.
What's that?
But
Brian, you make an excellent point. And in the event that it becomes a process that it, getting attachment permits to attach those poles, if it does become cumbersome and expensive, a directional bore is the way to go, and that's a form of fiber burial.
In Sandy, Oregon, rather than deal with that issue, buried everything.
Patty does have a question, apparently.
One of the things that was brought up during the presentation was the fact that some of the poles need to be replaced, and I know that's quite a large number that need to be replaced, and that will impact the timeline that Brian and Jerry were asking about earlier. So I was going to ask Johnny, let's just say we started tomorrow and we did nothing but replace the poles that need to be replaced to make them ready. What's the projected finish date?
We did nothing but replace poles.
If you did nothing but replace poles, let's say we hired a contractor that was going to go out there.
It just took them 6 weeks to replace 13.
Wow. And how many do we have that need to be replaced?
108.
But they weren't here for 6 weeks straight.
Yes, they were.
Wow. Because they were high officials. Wow.
But are they all like that?
They won't all be like that, but you can, I mean, even Johnny's crew, if they're just setting poles, you could do one every couple of days, Johnny?
That's if because when you change out the pole, you got to put it to the depth that it's supposed to be, and what we're finding out is when they hit rock, they stop, and that don't work now. So the one out here behind the Bryant Center, they drilled on for 2 days to get it down to the 3 foot that it was supposed to be.
What what I'm thinking as the next good step is for Patty and Melissa, perhaps, to start to contact the city manager in Hudson, the city manager in Fairlight, to find out what they did. How did they move forward? How did they do this research and investigation? You know, and maybe after that, maybe you find one of them has a little bit more affinity to Yellow Springs. Maybe there's a field trip with Johnny and Patty and who knows? But I mean, doesn't that seem like, because we don't even really know what the best way is to move forward, it sounds like. So,
so Hudson has a lot of its own governmental fiber, and all it's doing is extending it to four different business parks. It is doing it itself. It has a crew, like Johnny has a crew, and they're actually pulling their own wire. They're not contracting it out.
Well, I still would like Patty.
Oh yeah, no. And you know, they can talk about the process of doing a fiber engineering study. They had Magellan Associates do it, which is a big, good associate. And then Farallon, they're in the big beginning stages, and they have they're doing residential and businesses, although they're starting with businesses because there's a hotel near there. They're trying to get ready for the Republican committee convention.
I think it's a great idea for Patty to talk to these folks to see if there's essential information that you can discover for yourself. I think the overwhelming message is that there are options, and we're happy to assist in any way that you see fit. But we need to give you your options and see which way you think is best to proceed. But yes, this sounds great. There are a bunch of items in that second column from the left that we should also embark upon at the same time as all this is going on. But getting the real cost of the network is going to be priority number one. So I know, although I hear you say we don't necessarily want to do engineering now, I think we do need to start looking at how we can get the real cost of it.
Right, exactly. Yeah, I mean, that's to me what I would assume a consultant could do. This kind of preliminary project consultant, this RFP that we're talking about, they should at least be able to. I mean, that's what happened with our water plan. Unfortunately, it wasn't a very good estimate.
Right.
But so that may not be a good example. But I mean, that's, you always have some kind of preliminary estimate before you go to engineering, to full engineering. I don't know anybody that goes to full engineering without having a pretty good estimate of what a project's going to cost.
Scott Fife will be visiting Sandy, Oregon in the next month or so, right, Scott? And there's an opportunity there for him to meet with somebody.
There was a recent webinar series that was put on by the Ohio Department of Development that had to do with municipal fiber and the different ways that you can implement the fiber. Brian and Melissa actually attended one with me.
I attended the one today too.
Did you?
Yeah.
Good, because I didn't get to. But I mean, they had I thought the presenters from the firm up in is it New York or Pennsylvania? Anyway, I thought they were very informative, and I think probably contacting them would also be a
right. And then we got their PowerPoint.
Right.
I just want to say I do not disagree with, you know, obviously us doing our own discovery with some of these municipalities, but to me the decision that we need to make is, are we going to spend $50,000 to do a fiber engineering study? And so I don't know the why we need to wait that long to decide that.
Council meeting, right. Patty can have a report to us.
I'm being rhetorical. I'm saying that to me is, that's how we're going to ultimately be able to make a decision. So
well,
I
guess my question, my point is, though, it's possible that study, that there are other alternatives to doing a study like that. That's why I'd like her to, you know, take a few examples. Am I hearing? I feel like we're hearing some general support that we're at least going to go one more step. We're going to go one more step and at least do some initial investigation, you know, to come up with an RFP to spend money, that's going to be a couple, that's going to be a process too, because we're going to have to.
RFP for what?
For an engineering study, you know, I mean, so, I mean, that's certainly a next step after, if staff feels that that's kind of the next.
I guess I'm more and more disenchanted with consultants. You can't just say that across the board, of course, but my experience with the zoning and then with the water thing, I'm disenchanted and I'm impressed with what we have, so I don't want to spend money that we don't need to spend. And I mean, I'm not talking about the engineering study, but I'm talking about getting a consultant to look at things that it seems like we can
But I don't know that they, I think they're indicating that they don't necessarily have the capabilities of doing all of that work themselves.
I think if we went with the design build model, we could be very helpful. But I sense that that's not what council is really seriously considering here.
Well, we did a design build.
I think we have to legally understand the role of Thor and Mebeka. I mean, I didn't even ask that. I mean, I really do want to understand how that works. And I would be very concerned if Thor is, at the end of the day, going to be, I don't know if we can do it as a no bid kind of thing. I mean, Thor has a dog in the fight because Mebeka would get some contract out of this. So I think we have to talk about some sort of independence in decision making. And I
would like to point out that even if you did do a design build, you still need some kind of plan to let to get bids on. So you can't, sure. You still need to have some kind of engineering that goes with the packet that you put out that says, tell me how much you're going to charge me to build this thing. So I'm not qualified to design that. So.
But the feasibility study, what is that?
The feasibility study would be things like a survey for take rates. It would be part of how you would have to actively market it to make sure that you get the take rates, which is what Thor was talking about. I mean, is this feasible based on the information that we have that this is going to be a success? Is it enough of a possibility that we're willing to jump in and take that risk?
I'm wondering what town is, like you mentioned Leverett, Mass. And this other town, I forget which one.
Princeton, Sandy, Oregon. Yeah.
I mean, I know they're far away, but they're not in Ohio. But if the local places that you know are doing this are not local, but more near places are not really doing what we would be thinking about doing, are there other places that we should be looking to?
The city of Hamilton's been working on their own fiber network for 10 years, and they just actually started taking subscribers to it.
There's this primarily a business network, not...
It is primarily a business network, but they...
Well, I'm just asking these guys, yeah. is that really where we should be looking, or okay. Should we be looking at some other communities?
That's part of the feasibility study. Do you want to run it to all the homes? Do you want to start it with a limited rollout? Do you want, you know, how does it work best for the village to make this work?
But isn't that partly, do they do the financial? Does the feasibility study, is that the financial?
It could be if you wanted it to be included.
But aren't we talking about two different things? I mean, I thought what you were saying was, how about if we contact the two communities that they're saying are most like us? Because we can call them, we can Skype, we can...
Yeah, exactly.
We record the fiber forum, and you can get first-hand accounts from those recordings.
But we're trying to find out how the steps that the communities took, is that what they talked about?
Yeah, there's a wealth of information on this fiber forum.
City manager of Dublin, yeah, Dana something.
I can't remember his last name, but from Dublin.
That's right.
Dublink is another business network. As a matter of fact, the local people in Dublin are actually now petitioning to get it residential service.
So he would be a good contact.
I lived in Dublin for 12 years, and I had fiber in my home already, and you couldn't get fiber in Dublin. I was very disappointed.
And may I speak to that whole Mebeka thing that you just brought up? So we are a nonprofit, as you know this, but I just want to say it to everybody. We're a nonprofit. Council of Governments, our membership is made up of public school systems. We understand, and what we do is IT shared services. We spread the cost of IT implementations out to help multiple client organizations save money. We do not work for margins. We work to cover our costs. And I would just simply say, I don't really keep the fighting dogs, okay? Mine are puppies, and I just try and take good care of them. So, you know, I'm happy. Everything I do is 100% transparent and is a public record. You're welcome to look at my margins and my, you know, my cost and my, you know, and my fees at any time. All you have to do is give me a call, and I'll be happy to share that. But again, the reason we're interested in municipal infrastructure development is because we realize that there's a direct way to serve public schools, and then there's an indirect way. And lifting up an entire community helps a public school every bit as much as providing an efficient IT service. Okay?
To go back to the feasibility thing, I mean, a survey of citizens and businesses, I don't think we should do that.
I agree.
I think it's a waste of time. Because there won't be any marketing, and so people won't, you know, and it's already been done, basically. So I think that's the kind of thing I don't know. That's the one thing I can figure out that seems like we don't need to do that, but I don't know what we do need to do exactly, but.
I'd like to offer a suggestion if I might. Among the things in our second column there, there's a mechanism already in place that I think would help us answer two questions. One, how many households really are there? And two, perhaps we can get a better, more precise idea of what people's level of interest is. And you've got a mechanism already in place that we all get in the mail once a month. It's the utility bill. It would be very easy, I think, to craft whatever, a more focused, more specific kind of a survey that could go out in the utility bill and might be with a message from council saying, we're entertaining this idea and we would really like to get people to weigh in on it.
And that was something that Doug brought up today as a potential way to find out what that interest would be. And my response was, if you guys can come up with a short 5 or 6 question quick survey, we could potentially put those on the prepaid postcards that have, you know, already returned address, stick a label on the back of the questions, stick them in with the bill, and send them on off to the people.
The only issue with that is if people mail their bills in, it goes to a lockbox in Cincinnati, and if they put it in there, we wouldn't get it back. And a lot of people process their bills that way.
Postcard to just mail.
You can buy prepaid postcards at the post office.
Yeah, so it
doesn't go in the bill.
I mean, as long
just
as
tell
people
them not to put it.
Yeah,
down.
It just couldn't be something that went in the bill to be given back with the bill.
Right. I mean, I would just hate to hear this. They didn't ask me. I mean, somebody saying nobody asked me about this.
Because SurveyMonkey, you don't. And I'm not trying to rain on your parade, but you don't have to live in the village to answer SurveyMonkey.
Right.
You know,
and you can answer, one person could answer how many times.
But this is one of those things where, please put in your village account number. There's only one account.
Well, you could put in an address.
That's the key thing is not just put in any address. If you have an account and we can correlate it with a registered utility account, now you have, you know, trust. And that's where I've asked Melissa about, you know, if we had that actual list, we can actually get some ground truth because we're using the census figure, we're using the Greene County Auditor. The utility accounts are the real thing. People are paying on them, I assume, because the lights are still on.
But are we not going to do it if we don't get a good survey return? If we say to people, you can have better service for less, are you for it or not?
Well, some of the things that we talked about today, Matt's raising his hand, were, you know, if you got this service for $40 a month, and once you signed up, Time Warner came in and said, I'll get the same thing for $30 a month, would you still stay? That kind of thing.
I just think people need to if people understand it, and they're not going to understand it now, I don't think. I didn't understand it until I prepared for the meeting and then, you know, came here. You know, I thought if they're undercut, you know, for a short time they undercut the rate, then we're going to lose people. But if the quality is that much greater, and actually you can add things in, so in fact it's still going to be cheaper, then, but people aren't going to understand it. That's why I feel like it's going to be meaningful.
And I think there's something to be said for maybe the survey isn't necessary. But I mean, I would like to understand things like that. You know, what happens if all of a sudden Time Warner comes in with this big deal and we lose, over a 2-year period, we lose half of our,
right.
You know, this woman is sitting here worried about how we're going to pay for the bond. Right. And if we don't have users, well, we are all sitting here worried about how we're going to pay for the bond. And if we don't have users and subscriptions to pay for the bond, it is coming out of the general fund.
Because the thing you have to, here's the tipping point for me. We have to figure out how long we can go losing customers and still be able to pay the bond out of the revenues fund, okay, before we start to have to dip into something else. Because there's no question in my mind that Time Warner Cable and AT&T have way deeper pockets than we do, and that's the tipping point. Is where is that, and that could be part of the feasibility study. How long can you carry the payments out of the bond fund if you continue to lose customers because they're undercutting you?
Well, I have a bit of a different take. One is about, I think it is important for the community to be learning about this. Mm-hmm. Like, whomever is saying. So we need to have some, we need to start getting information on. But look at the water plan. I mean, we're doing our own water plan because people wanted our own water plan. There's a lot of identification with having our own thing here. So I think if we get enough information out to people, people are gonna go with this, because they certainly rather have Yellow Springs, whatever, than Time Warner or AT&T or...
Well, I don't disagree with what you're saying, but at the same time, I know how many times they get yelled at downstairs because of the increase in the water rate.
And that's the thing, is with the water, you know, people don't have a choice where they can get their water, but they have a choice where they can get their internet, and and this community is very concerned about their own bottom line. And if we're offering it for $40 a month and Time Warner comes in for $30 a month and their budgets are already constricted,
and they get it to you for a year,
they have a choice in the matter versus the water. And that's what makes me nervous, because I work in the utility office, and I hear the feedback on a daily basis as to what the rate increases have done. And I see that firsthand with everybody that walks in down there. So with the water, they don't have a choice, but with the cable, they do. So that's what concerns me.
Do we think, Fanny, do you think we have enough direction to know what we need?
The first thing I can do is I can start making the calls, talking to the other communities that have done this, both successfully and not successfully, ask them what the process was they went through, what their next steps would be. I can certainly do that and have that report for council at the next council meeting.
And I guess from a council standpoint, is there something could we want to make this decision within the next few meetings? We don't want it
If it's a feasibility study, whatever the next step is, I would like to make a concrete next step.
Yeah, and if technically we can't do it in this meeting, then we need to be able to do it in our next meeting so that we can move forward, right? Because we really can't make a decision.
Even at that meeting, what we'll be directing Patty to do potentially is draft an RFQ, draft an RFP, whatever it might be. Matt.
So it's delightful that we're talking about a next step, and everyone's had something really important to say. So I just want to kind of frame this the way I see it in my mind as to what to do next. There are really two important things that need to get firmed up, and they need to get firmed up, and that's a part of that second column there, and that's the revenue side, which is the subscribers, which is how many people in the village are going to jump on this bandwagon, right? And then there's the cost side. So if there was a way to proceed on what to do next, it seems like the cheaper way to find out more is to ask the people in the village, you know, would you be willing to, you know, to complete this survey somehow, right? To the number of subscribers, you know, fashion five very direct questions. Would, if you had a choice between Time Warner at this lower speed and whatever service for a shorter period of time, or the municipally owned service at a slightly higher price, but that way forever and we own it, which would you choose? You know, real direct questions like this, you know. I think that for the lower amount of money, like initial outlay, to find out this information, we will learn more from the revenue side than the feasibility study, which it could be, or the engineering study, which in my mind is putting together a great big parts list with associated costs, which, you know, is the consultant's you know, route, right? In closing, I think that, you know, asking people what they would be willing to pay for so that we can firm up the revenue side of things first, that would be the quickest and easiest and probably less expensive way.
Not only will I make these calls and write at least the brief for council, Melissa tells me that it is feasible to include a full page explanation and the postcard in the bills. It will cost us about how much?
Well, I know that when we do the water quality report, that was like $1,500 for one piece of paper.
Okay, so if someone from SpringsNet could write an explanation, an educational piece, which I think is what Judith is saying is important, that here's what we're looking at, here's what we're talking about, we need you to answer a few questions, please see the enclosed postcard, which, by the way, we want you to mail separately. And then we'll come up with the six short questions that are what we need to know. And then if you guys can come up with those, we can maybe include them in the bills. And, or what's the deadline you're at this week?
I don't think we could get it done this month, not so, within this timeline. It would have to go
Let's talk about it. I mean, let's have them prepare them. But I think, you know, Judith said, so if we don't get great survey results, are we just going to drop it?
Right.
I don't know that I feel like that. I feel like that we're going to get the best survey results with a phone survey. I don't know that this mailback survey is going to be, it's just not scientific. It's just then, so I mean, I think it's one thing to consider, figure out how much it's going to cost, what the time frame is. Maybe you could call Coupa or somebody and find out how much a phone survey
and
costs.
I actually wrote that down, and when I talked to Coupa last year about the potential levy survey, it was around $8,000 to do a phone survey. So
also, we could put something in the paper, maybe a couple of weeks.
Right.
Have something on Channel 5.
Right. We could have letters to the editor.
And frankly, I mean, I'd rather. When I get a survey on the phone, I mostly hang up. So
I don't think they would. If it's identified as immediately as village related, I think people would. We've done pretty well when we did surveys in the past. I don't know. I mean, I tend to agree with you, Marianne, that it will be a source of pride. It will be. You know, I think if the numbers are what they are, and I think even say $10, ranging $10 down, I don't know that that's going to get somebody to drop a subscription. You know, if they go down much lower than that, I think it's more about, I mean, this $40 number that seems to be comparable, that, I mean, I think figuring out if that's a real number, that to me is important.
Right, but you can't figure out if that's a real number until you know what your take rate's going to be at what rate.
Well, I think you can. Right. I mean, maybe once we get some of these, if Melissa can work on the numbers, I mean, maybe getting some accurate numbers going through those 2,200 bills and figuring out which ones don't really apply, if there are ones that don't apply, maybe we can get a firmer number of.
I can go through a month's billing journals and figure that out.
And it is notable, we heard that the average take rate for municipal is 55%. I mean, that tells me a lot. Because Yellow Springs, exactly what Marianne said.
Sandy is in the 60% range now. And they do have competition as well.
in Leverett, Massachusetts, which didn't operate a DSL service, is up to 80%. But they are totally in the Berkshires. There's nothing there.
No, there's nothing. So. Well, I mean, I think we have a path forward, at least for the next meeting, and then maybe we can make a little bit, go another step forward.
Okay. So are we doing a survey or no? Because
we'll decide the next meeting. I mean, I think that's part of what you can bring to the next meeting is, I mean, I personally, $1,500 to send the survey out, I think that's a waste of money. I mean, I mean, at least with a phone survey, it costs a lot more, but at least I feel like it's more scientific.
The value is that everyone who gets a bill at least sees this and goes, oh, the village is doing something. I mean, it's part of a outreach as much as anything.
I mean, it could even be two-pronged, where there's an insert that goes in the bill that's priming people for a phone call that informs them. I mean, it could go hand in hand so that there is an informational piece that does get to every household and business, and then we follow up with whatever method is chosen.
And again, that's part of what Patty can find out when she's talking to these other communities. How did you introduce this to your customers? How did the word get out? When you talk to her, marketing is a huge thing to me. I am really curious as to how these municipalities are marketing against companies whose business it is to market.
But you know, to me, if the service is that good, it, word of mouth in this town is going to go a long way. You know, so I think that
it's already going to be just going to be another line on your utility bill. It's not, you're not getting a separate bill from two internet providers, AT&T or Time Warner. You're getting it with your water, your sewer.
And also, assuming there's something we're going to have to do, I mean, I can't imagine that we, you know, the village is going to have to give people their options.
Right.
I mean, they can't go and say, you have to sign up for
No, they have to give consent to have someone.
So I'm not sure how that all goes.
But Melissa's, I've already talked with Melissa and Johnny about the billing module that, on the system you're already using.
Which we're looking to switch, so.
Huh?
That throws a wrench in it. We're looking to switch.
Well, we'll adapt.
Yeah.
Jake, do you have anything to add? Smart guy in the room?
I'm just a resident, so I haven't spent the year and a half with these guys, but one thing I can say that kind of hit home to me is when I first moved back to town, I did telecommute for 5 years, and I'm an engineer, and the slow upload speeds were really relevant to me. I mean, it actually affected my day-to-day. And so it's not just bringing, I think somebody's mentioned it, it's not just bringing in a big business, but it's making it feasible for people who want to come to Yellow Springs or come back to Yellow Springs, make it feasible for them to telecommute in a realistic way.
Great, well, I think we're ready to adjourn the meeting. Thanks everybody who is the SpringsNet folks, staff folks for being here. This was a good meeting.
Thank you so much.
Second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Before